is considered to be the father of Armenian history. He's been called the Herodotus of the Armenians. He was a multi-talented person. Besides being a historian, he was a poet, a grammarian. He's written a book about the grammar of the Armenian language. And he also was a hymn writer. He has written several sharagans, the most famous of which is the Nativity Sharagan, Khorutmertsev Skancheli, which is sung in all Armenian churches during the Advent season. Khorutmertsev Skancheli, vor ais mahur haydnetsar, hoviv kerken entreshtar dnavelis ashkari, dnav nor arka impertien gavi. This comes from the pen of Moses Khorenatsi. So every time we celebrate Christmas and we sing this sharagan, we remember him and we thank him for his efforts. He was a disciple of Saint Mesrop Mashtots, and together with a group of the brightest Armenian young men was sent to Alexandria, Egypt by Katholikos Sahak Bartev to study Greek philosophy and Christian theology. At that time, Alexandria, Egypt was the center, was one of the most prominent centers for the study of Greek philosophy and Christian theology. So in the year 432, Moses Khorenatsi with other young students were sent to Alexandria, Egypt, where they remained for 6 years. And Khorenatsi says when they returned to Armenia, they discovered that their patron, Katholikos Sahak Bartev, and their mentor, Suk Mesro Mashtots, had died. And Khorenatsi has written a lamentation for Suk Mesro Mashtots and Sahak Bartev, which is found as an appendix at the end of his History of Armenia. When he returned to Armenia, the Persians were persecuting the Armenian clergy because the Armenians had left Zoroastrians, embraced Christianity, and therefore had developed closer ties with Persia's arch-rival Byzantium. So the Persian proconsul in Armenia persecuted the prominent, most prominent Armenian clergymen, and we know that Moses Khorenatsi hid himself in a village near Varshabad for several years until he was discovered by Catholicos Kut, who ordained him bishop of Akrevan. Now, he says that he was commissioned by Prince Sahak Bakraduni to write the history of Armenia. And we know that Prince Sahak Bakraduni died in a battle with the Persians in the year 482 AD. But he was the one who commissioned Moses Khorenatsi to write the history of Armenia. And in the preface of his book, Moses Khorenatsi gives us his reason for writing the history of Armenia. He says, although we are a small nation and our homeland has been conquered by foreign invaders, yet on this land, on our ancestral land, many heroic acts have been performed which must be recorded and remembered, and of which no one has bothered to write down, until he took his pen and started writing. So we know that Moses Khorenatsi was born around 410 AD. The exact date of his birth cannot be ascertained, but we know he was, again, there are questions about his birthplace. Armenian historians have been puzzled over this. Where was he born? Some say he was born in the village of Horon in the Daron province, which is near Mush. Others say he was born in the village of Horena, which is in the province of Sunik. So where was he born? Some say he was born in the village of Horena in Sunik. Others say he was born in a village called Horon, which is in the province of Daron near Mush. Armenian historians seem to be unable to settle this matter, but I believe I found a solution for it. At least in my mind, it's a settled matter. Let me give you the reason. We know that when he died in the year 490 AD, he was buried in the monastery of Sup Arakelots, which is in Mush, not far from Horenatsi's birthplace, the village of Horon. Usually when a person dies, they try to bury him in his birthplace or near his birthplace. So the fact that he was buried in Mush, not too far from his birthplace, the village of Horon, I believe that he must have been born in the Daron province, not in Sunik. Unfortunately, the original manuscript of the History of Armenia is lost. We don't have it. We don't have the original manuscript. The oldest manuscripts that we have is from the 14th century. So it's a copy of a copy of a copy. Now, Ghazar Parbetsi, another Armenian historian who lived around 500 AD, mentions Movses Horenatsi in passing. He says, our beloved philosopher Movses was persecuted by the Persians. But he calls him philosopher, not a historian. But most people believe that this reference in Ghazar Parbetsi pertains to Movses Horenatsi. The book, History of Armenia, consists of three books, or is divided into three subdivisions. The first one is called The Genealogy of Armenia, and records Armenian history from its pre-Christian era, from the time the Armenian nation originated. And he's the first Armenian historian to write such a comprehensive history of Armenia. The other historians don't start with Haifna Abel, the way Horenatsi does. So he has preserved the oral traditions of the pre-Christian era. All the Armenian legends and mythology of the pre-Christian era have come to us through Movses Horenatsi. So the first book, the first subdivision, book one, is about the genealogy of Armenia, consists of 32 chapters. Book two deals with the Arshakuni dynasty, the Parthian and Roman and Sassanid era, and has 92 chapters. This is the longest one. And book three deals with Arshak II and Arshak III, and has 68 chapters. So you see, it's a gigantic work. He mentions his dependence on a historian called Eusebios of Caesarea. This is not Caesarea of Armenia, Caesarea of Palestine. Eusebios of Caesarea, Caesarea Palestine, wrote a history of the Christian church around 250 AD. He's considered to be the second Christian historian. The first church historian was the evangelist Luke, who wrote Acts Acts of the Apostles, which is incorporated in the New Testament. It's one of the books of the New Testament. It's a history of what the apostles did, history of the first Christian apostolic church. And Eusebius is the second historian who has written the history of the church from the time of the apostles to his day. Saint Masrop Mashtots translated Eusebius' history of the Christian church into Armenian. So this was available for Mofses Korenatsi. Eusebius' history of the Christian church was available in Armenian for Mofses Korenatsi, and he mentions Eusebius and his history of the, in his history of Armenia, and acknowledges his dependence on him. Eusebius' history of the Christian church contains fragmentary information about the most prominent ancient Egyptian historian, Maneto, the most prominent Jewish historian, Josephus, and the most prominent Phoenician historian, Philo of Byblos. Now there are two Philos. There's a Philo of Alexandria. Philo of Alexandria was a Jew who wrote in Greek. He's written 40 books of philosophy, Greek philosophy. His aim was to show that Judaism is compatible with Hellenistic culture and philosophy. And he was able to do this by allegorizing the Old Testament. Everything in the Old Testament he allegorized. Well, that was Philo of Alexandria. And he was contemporary of Jesus Christ during the first century AD. Now, Philo of Byblos has written the history of Phoenicia, ancient Lebanon. And he wrote his history around 141 AD. Now, Eusebius has quotations from these historians in his history of the Christian church. Like he says, Maneto claims that Ramses II of Egypt accomplished more exploits than Alexander the Great. And Josephus, in his book, The Antiquities of the Jews, traces the history of the Jewish nation to Noah's son, Shem, or Sam. And he shows that by being an old nation, they have a rich civilization. And then Philo of Byblos, who's written the history of Phoenicia, he says King Hiram of Phoenicia was as great as Alexander the Great. And so these three historians, Maneto of Egypt, Philo of Byblos, and Josephus, have been dubbed apologetic historians. Apologetic historians. What do we mean by apologetic historians? They try to show that the older the nation, the superior its civilization. And Mofses Korenatsi has modeled his first book, The Genealogy of Armenia, after these apologetic historians, Maneto of Egypt, Philo of Byblos, and Josephus. So he's an apologetic historian. I said earlier that the pre-Christian oral traditions, legends, mythology have been preserved to us by Mofses Korenatsi. If it were not for Mofses Korenatsi Book 1, The Genealogy of Armenia, we would not know today about Dork Anker. It is said that Dork Anker was able to throw rocks as huge as hills on ships in the Black Sea and sink them. Is the Armenian Ulysses, I guess. Mofses Korenatsi tells us about the romance the romantic relationship between King Ardashes and Satenik. And by the way, Satenik wasn't Armenian. She was Alan, belonged to a nation called Alan. They don't exist today. But Movses Hornatsi tells us about the battle between Haik, Nahabet, and Pel, the tyrant. Movses Hornatsi says Haik, the name Haik, is the plural of I. Haik, it's the plural of I. And then he says, Haik was the name that the Armenians gave to the Orion constellation. The Orion constellation was called Haik by the early Armenians. Movses Hornatsi tells us that. He likens Haik to the giants that are mentioned in the Bible. And he likens Haik's son, Aram, to Joshua. You remember Joshua, after the death of Moses, was the one who conquered the promised land from the Philistines and the Canaanites. And Aram, according to Hornatsi, was the one who set the boundaries of Armenia. Tells us about the crush which the Assyrian queen Shamiram had on the Armenian king Artaxerxes, and how she invaded Armenia to get him. And when he was killed in battle, she took him to the upper floor of her palace and brought certain dogs called Aralizk that tried to lick him back to life. That these dogs were believed if they licked a dead person, they could bring him back to life. So this story also comes to us from, and most important, he tells us about the letter of King Abgar of Edessa to Jesus, inviting him to Armenia, and how St. Thaddeus and Bartholomew, two apostles of Christ, came to Armenia after Jesus' resurrection and ascension and preached the gospel to the Armenians. This whole story comes to us from Hornatsi. Now, Hornatsi is the one who tells us that Edessa was an Armenian kingdom and Abkar was an Armenian king. But Assyrian history says Edessa was an Assyrian king. And they claim Abkar to be an Assyrian king. Well, we believe Hornatsi. Because King Abkar invited Jesus to Armenia, not to Assyria. Okay? So, Edessa could have been as an Assyrian kingdom. At one time, it probably was an Assyrian kingdom, but later on, it became an Armenian. That's not a thorny problem. So all these stories come to us from Hornatsi. If it were not for him, we would not have known about all these interesting stories. Now there are some historical inconsistencies and anachronisms in Hornatsi's history of Armenia. These have been brought to light in the 19th century. Until the 19th century, people thought, everybody believed that Hornatsi was unquestionably right. He was the greatest authority on Armenian history. And whatever he wrote was absolutely right. Nobody questioned that. But in the 19th century, historians started analyzing his work, and they found some historical inconsistencies and anachronisms. Let me mention some. You have probably heard of Robert W. Thompson. He was the chair of Armenian studies at Harvard University. And he was the one who points out some of the anachronisms or historical inconsistencies in Hornatsi's work. Let me mention some. Nazi equates the province of Sunik with Sisagan. Khorin Atzi tells us that the province of Sunik and Sisagan are one and the same. But Syriac historical sources say that the Syriacs started calling the province of Sunik Sisagan in the 7th century. So before the 7th century, Sunik was not called Sisagan. So if Khorin Atzi was born in 410 AD and died in 490 AD, he couldn't have known that Sunik and Sisagan were one and the same, because Sunik started being called Sisagan in the 7th century by the Assyrians. That's one. Number two, Khorin Atzi mentions four Armenians in his book. Four Armenians. These are the four Armenian provinces that Emperor Justinian organized. Emperor Justinian, in the year 591 AD, divided Armenia into four provinces. And this happened in 591. Remember, Khorin Atzi died in 498. This happened in 591. So how could he know about the four provinces of Armenia if he died in 490? So he must have lived, some people concluded, he must have lived in the 7th century, not 4th century. Third, Khorin Atzi tells us about the Persians' advance westward into Bithynia. Now, Bithynia is in Northwest Asia Minor, or was in Northwest Asia Minor. From historical sources, we know that that happened in 629 AD. It was only in 629 AD that the Persians were able to advance as far west as Bithynia. Four, Khorin Atzi refers to the Byzantine governors of Armenia as Goms. He calls them Goms. And the Byzantine governors of Armenia were given this title, Goms, in 629 AD, not earlier. Another thing, he says King Khosrov of Armenia pursued King Ardashir, the Sasanian king of Persia, as far as India. There's no historical source that can corroborate this. So only Khorin Atzi tells this, but there's no other historical source. There's no Persian source, no Greek or Roman source to verify this. Then, Khorin Atzi tells us that Saint Gregory the Illuminator was conceived on the grave of Saint Thaddeus. And many believe this was improbable, that the mother of Saint Gregory conceived while lying on the grave of Saint Thaddeus. Third, another one, we're well beyond now. Khorin Atzi tells us that Saint Gregory the Illuminator was married to a lady called Mariam. Agathangelos tells us he was married to Julita. So, which one is right? Agathangelos or Khorin Atzi? All of them lived in the 5th century.